and several programs throughout the state must be undertaken. And on my behalf, much before that, I have already written an article in Gujarati regarding Ramanujan. Srinivas Ramanujan, in Gujarati I am speaking, Chitre Vitadela Ratanni Khoch. This is the title that I gave, and my article just a year before was published in a journal, Navneet Samarpan, Gujarati Navneet Samarpan, which is very well read in Gujarati public. It is already published. So I now wish that those who would like to know a little more about Ramanujan and would like to inspire themselves also from the life of Ramanujan must please go through this article. And later on, the same article, after 6 months or so, I got it published in a Vignan Vani, which is published by the Community Science Center in Baroda. So this is one point which I wanted to make. It was not a remark or anything, but I thought that this is not known, and I got this opportunity from this platform to speak and to make it published that at least Gujarati newspapers in Gujarat must take a good note of it so that the public in Gujarat know this and celebrate this kind of event right from primary level to the college and the university level. Every year, 22nd December is a National Mathematics Day. So, sir, not much that I have to make any remark first, but to request you to start your lecture.
Respected Professor B.M. Shah, dear professors, guests, teachers, students, and admirers of mathematics who have assembled here. I'm very happy, I feel honored to have been invited to deliver a lecture named after the great Srinivas Ramanujan. I have chosen a topic. It is of my great interest and which I hope will be of great interest to every one of you. To talk about the achievements of our ancestors in the subject of mathematics. This lecture, unlike my other talks, is planned slightly differently. Mostly I am only a transmitter, and several scholars in the world are going to talk to you through me today. In other words, my lecture is profusely having quotations from different experts from different geographic regions, and different ages also. The title of the lecture is Foreigners Fascinated by Ancient Indian Mathematics, which is available in several books of Sanskrit language. First, there is a summary of what I am going to say. There are hundreds of foreign scholars who admire the ancient Indian contributions to the development of mathematics. Hundreds with plural yes is correct. I have myself gone through 200 to 300 books of foreigners. Now I present about a score of them, or maybe a dozen of them. This can be stopped abruptly at any time. I have decided to take only 1 hour. I am sure that I will not be completing all this material within 1 hour, but I will stop at the end of the hour. In each case, I am mentioning some words about the scholar who is appreciating Indian mathematics, from which country does he come, during which period did he live, what are his distinctions, and what has he written about the ancient Indian mathematics, in which book I am giving the references, and what is a sampled Sanskrit passage of relevance that has made the scholar to admire Indian mathematics, what is the English meaning of that passage, and what is so great about that contribution of India. This is what I am going to say. One by one, there is a big list of eminent people, and this is only a sublist there. Hermann Hankel, the German mathematician. Henry Thomas Kohlbrook, a great orientalist. Charles M. Wish from East India Company. W. Dunham, professor of mathematics. A. Seidenberg, historian of science. A. L. Basham, a historian from Australia. Dick Teresi, American editor and author. Donald E. Knuth, computer scientist. Laplace, French mathematician. Fritz Starr, professor of philosophy. J. Diogene, French mathematician. Carl B. Boyer, a historian of science. André Weil, a French mathematician. E. F. Robertson, professor emeritus at University of St. Andrews. Cajoli F., a historian from Switzerland. And H. W. Eves, American mathematician. George Sorten, Belgian chemist and historian. Albert Einstein, Benjamin Lee, G. B. Halstead, W. W. Hunter, Monier Williams, M. Elphinstone, and Dr. Thibault. These are some of the persons from whom I will be quoting. I start with the first one, Hermann Hankel. We, those who learned mathematics at higher level, who had been talking about Hankel transforms, Hankel rings, and so on. From 19th century, was a German mathematician. He studied and worked with very great mathematicians like Mobius, Riemann, Verstaas, Schwanecker. In 1867, he wrote an exposition on complex numbers and quaternions, and that exposition is particularly memorable. He writes, I'm quoting from Hankel, it, because my quotation starts from the middle of an article, I have to explain what that it is Bhaskaracharya's Chakrabala method he is appreciating. It is beyond all praise. It is certainly the finest thing achieved in the theory of numbers before Lagrange. Please note the superlatives. Coming from a great mathematician, he says Bhaskara's Chakrabala method is the finest thing achieved in the theory of numbers before Lagrange's time. Lagrange himself has solved the same problem independently. And corroborating that statement with two other quotes, both about Bhaskara. In many ways, Bhaskaracharya represents a peak of mathematical knowledge in the 12th century AD. He reached an understanding of the number systems and solving equations which was not to be achieved in Europe for several centuries, writes an European. Kannan and Robertson of Scotland, I took it from his website. What did Bhaskara achieve? Of course, he achieved many things, and I am giving only one sample. This is a Diophantine equation. 61 x square plus 1 equal to y square. Of course, there are many, many other Diophantine equations which Bhaskaracharya and even earlier Indian mathematicians have solved. But this has made a mark. What is a Diophantine equation? We want to find solutions in integers. I want to find integers x and y satisfying this particular equation. If I put x equal to 0 and y equal to 1, I am immediately getting one solution, because 61 into 0 square plus 1 is becoming 1 square. But that is called a trivial solution. We are looking for non-trivial solutions. This problem is posed and also solved together with a very valuable algorithm called the cyclic algorithm of Chakrabala method in Bhaskaracharya's book Leelavati. And I am quoting that shloka in which this problem is mentioned. There is one more reason for quoting the shloka. This is to say that mathematics and poetry have blended. This is in a melodious Vasanta Tilaka meter. Many of you may have come across this meter in some prayer songs or elsewhere in Sanskrit. Ka sapta shashti gunita kriti veka yukta ka chaika shashti gunita ka sakhe sarupa syan mulaka yadi kriti prakriti nitantam tachetasi prabhadata tatata latavati. This is from Bhaskaracharya. Bhaskaracharya's work is known as well for poetry as for mathematics. In mathematics, this only poses the problem, particularly the second line poses this particular problem. First line poses a similar problem with the coefficient 67. Eka shashti 61 gunita multiplied by 61. Kriti means a square number. Which square number, when multiplied by 61, and then sarupa, sarupa means 1, sarupa means together with 1, that gives 61 x square plus 1, molada syat, I'm going to third line, will give a square root, which means will be itself a perfect square. That is the problem. 61 x square plus 1 y equal to y square is to be solved. It is put in a different way. Which square number when multiplied by 61 and added with 1 will itself be a square number? This is the problem that he is posing. And there is a big anecdote related to this problem. The same problem with the same coefficient 61 has been posed later after several centuries by the great mathematician Fermat also, but Fermat could not solve it. He posed it, he wrote letters to many other mathematicians. It was later solved by equally great mathematicians like Euler and Lagrange. But in 12th century AD, Bhaskara not only solved it, but also found a general method of solving all such similar equations. This is taken from the recent book. This is also a quote. One of Bhaskara's feats in number theory, remember he uses the word feat and then says one of the feats, consisted in finding the smallest positive integer solution of 61 x square plus 1 equal to y square. What is the solution that Bhaskara announced as the smallest one? X equal to 22,61,53,980 and Y equal to 176,63,19,049. This will satisfy that equation and nothing smaller will. This is the smallest. If we try in our own trial and error method, starting with X equal to 1 and so on, one human lifespan is not enough to come to this number, assuming that we take a second to verify each. It is such a big number. Bhaskara could do it because he was a mathematician and he knew tricks, he knew algorithms. This tribute is paid by W.S. Andlin in his book, this is a recent book, Mathematics, a Concise History and Philosophy. This is in a series Undergraduate Text in Mathematics, Springer Verlag Publishers, 1994. There is much more to say about this itself, this feat of Bhaskaracharya, how others have attempted it, how others have failed, how others are thinking that their method is the first time discovery of that. There is so much written in history of mathematics books, but I'm skipping them, I'm omitting them. I'm going to the second scholar whom we are going to quote today, Henry Thomas Colebrook, from 1765 to 1836. A civilian of the East India Company, who later turned into a great Orientalist and organizer of Oriental studies, but he was not a mathematician, but he was the historian of mathematics. He wrote on the Vedas, he wrote on Sanskrit grammar, he wrote on Indian jurisprudence books of law, he wrote also on algebra, arithmetic, astronomy, and geography. One of his books, published in the year 1817, is The Algebra of the Hindus. In that book, he asserts that, this is a quote, even though I have forgotten to put the quotation mark there. I am quoting him. When sciences flourished in India, England was in the Stone Age. He himself hails from England, but he is admiring India so much, particularly the ancient India, and therefore he had the courage to write. When sciences flourished in India, England was in the Stone Age. I am also giving the reference from which I have taken this. In his book titled Miscellaneous Essays, he writes the following. There the Hindus understood well the arithmetic of third roots, equations of the second degree, and this was as near an approach to a general solution as was made until the days of Lagrange. This is formula for finding the roots of a quadratic equation. This is the title page of one of the books written by Colebrook, Hindu Algebra. I'm quoting a Sanskrit passage, this time from some other Indian mathematician, Mahaviracharya, a Jain mathematician, Jain by religion. His book is titled Ganita Sara Sangraha. This Ganita Sara Sangraha is consisting of 1,200 Sanskrit shlokas. In each shloka, both poetry and mathematics will be combined. A very valuable book, translated into many languages, including Hindi, English, Telugu, and so on. I'm reading one passage from there. Gajayuthasya triyamshah shesha padamcha trisangunam sanav sarasit trihastinibhihi nago drishtah katih gajah. Translation is available. One third of a herd of elephants and 3 times the square root of the remaining part were seen on the mountain slope. And in a lake was seen a male elephant along with 3 female elephants. How many elephants are there? This is just to give a flavor of how his mathematics exercises were. This amounts to the equation x divided by 3 plus 3 multiplied by the square root of 2x by 3, the remaining 1 minus x by 3, plus 4 more elephants separately in the leg makes the whole x. Then this we have to square, make it a quadratic equation and then solve. Solution of the quadratic equation was known in India even much before Maharaja. The formula that we teach in the schools now at the 9th class, that is, I should also add that the NCERT books mentions it, that is of Indian origin, available in one Sridharacharya's book. Answer to this problem is x equal to 24. One can substitute and see. I'm going to a third scholar, a very, very great admirer of Indian mathematics, Charles M. Wish. He is from the Madras establishment of East India Company. He wrote in one of his papers, that he has written many sentences of admiration, the value of pi, which comes in geometry in the chapter on circuits. This was computed in certain works of Hindu mathematics, and he quotes from 4 such works, starting from Aryabhatta's work in the 5th century. In this sentence, there is nothing superlative, but he continues to write, the approximations to the true value, this is a long sentence, probably to understand the meaning, I should split it into shorter ones. The approximations to the true value of the circumference with a given diameter, that is, pi is the ratio of the circumference of a circle to the diameter of the circle, the approximations to that number pi, exhibited in Indian works, there are many mathematics books in India approximating that, they are so wonderfully correct, those approximations, that European mathematicians who seek for such proportions in the doctrine of fluxions, the doctrine of fluxions is the then name for what we now call as differential calculus, proposed by Newton and Leibniz. Nowadays, if you want to find an approximate value of pi, usually we refer to the differential calculus method. The European mathematicians who seek for this in that theory are in the more tedious continual bisection of an arc. There is one small type mistake here. This A-R-E-R should be corrected as O-R-R. Either in differential calculus or in the more tedious continual bisection of an arc, they will wonder, those European mathematicians will wonder, by what means the Hindu has been able to extend the proportion to so great a length. Such a good approximation the Hindu is getting, but what is the method? Because at that time differential calculus was not there. This is what Charles M. Wish is writing. And taking more from one of his articles, Aryabhatta, who flourished in the beginning of 37th century of Kali Yuga, of which 4,920 years have passed when Charles M. Wish wrote this article, has in his work, that is Aryabhatiyam, in which he mentions the period of his birth, Aryabhatta's birth, exhibited at the in Aryabhatiyam, he mentions the period of his birth, and that is how we know exactly when he was born. Aryabhatta exhibited the proportion of the diameter to the circumference of the circle as 20,000 to 62,832. That is 6,282 divided by 20,000 as an approximate value of pi. In the following verse, this verse is of Aryabhatta. Chaturadhikam shatam ashta gunam. द्वादश त्रिशत सहस्राणाम् अयुत द्वय पिष्टम्भस्य आसन्नो वृत्तपरिणाहः. वृत्त मीन्स सर्किल, परिणाहः मीन्स सर्कम्फरेंस, आसन्नः मीन्स अप्रॉक्सिमेट, पिष्टम्भ मीन्स डायमीटर. ही ट्रांसलेट्स इट, द प्रोडक्ट ऑफ 100 इंक्रीज्ड बाय 4 and multiplied by 8, added to 60 and 2,000 is the circumference of a circle whose diameter is twice 10,000. That number is already written there above. I am quoting from a later work. The Sanskrit passage is not from Aryabhatiyam but from some other work. But here it is much more approximate. एवं चात्रपदार्थ विस्तृति महावृत्तस्य राहोक्षरैः. अगेन वर्स शार्दूल विक्रीडितं मीटर, वेरी फेमस मीटर. स्याद् भद्रां बुधि सिद्ध जन्म गणित श्रद्धा स्मयद्धा पुगीः. द नंबर इज मेंशन ओनली इन द सेकंड लाइन. फर्स्ट लाइन इज मेंशनिंग द कॉन्टेक्स्ट इन विच द नंबर कम्स. द नंबर इज 3.14149265358979324. This is the number mentioned there. How were they able to mention in a single sentence this particular number? There is a method called katapaya by which letters will represent numbers. And numbers have to be read from right to left. This passage ends with gi, then pu, then bha. Each letter stands for one number. Gi for number 3, pu for number 1, bha for number 4 and so on. And therefore if it is read like this, I am getting this number. But it is not difficult to remember which letter stands for which number. Gi is just the third letter in our alphabet, ka, kha, ga. Therefore gi is for 3. Pu is, I must mention that this system is called katapayadi. That means ka, pa, pa, ya, these four numbers, four symbols are starting symbols, number 1. Pu, pa stands for number 1. Bha stands for pa, pa, ba, bha, the fourth one there. Therefore it is number 4 and so on. If you write the entire thing according to that rule called the katapayadi rule, I am getting this particular number, a very fine approximation for the number 5. I am now passing on to the fourth one, W. Dunham. He is a professor of mathematics. His dad was named after Truman Kohler. He is in the Department of Mathematics and Computer Science in Muhlenberg College. He has written many books. Journey Through Genius, The Great Theorems of Mathematics. That is the title of one of his books. Mathematical Universe. That is the title of another of his books. And he is going to talk about the contribution of India to trigonometry. In fact, the entire subject of trigonometry was born in India and developed in India long ago. This verse is taken from one book called Karana Paddhati, written in Kerala. Anyonya koti hatayoho abhipatunayos triti vajahatayoho योगनियौ गौस्यातां अभिपत गुणचापयोग विपत गुणौ आर्याभट. मीनिंग साइन ए प्लस बी इक्वल टू साइन ए कॉस बी प्लस कॉस ए साइन बी, वेयरएज साइन ए माइनस बी इक्वल टू साइन ए कॉस बी माइनस कॉस ए साइन बी. दिस इज अ ट्रिग्नोमेट्रिक एडिशन फार्मूला रिटन इन दिस श्लोक. आई एम कोटिंग नाउ डब्ल्यू डनहम. द इंडियंस एक्सेल्ड इन मैथमेटिक्स. Among their foremost achievements was the development of trigonometry. The entire trigonometry that we learn in schools nowadays is available in old Sanskrit books. From Aryabhata's time onwards, Aryabhata's work is famous for the sign table. Many are wondering how did he calculate the values of sine function so accurately. This is taken from the book Mathematical Universe. Next, A. Seidenberg is an American mathematician and historian of science. He wrote the book The origin of mathematics is an archive for history of exact sciences, published in the year 1978. He says, the oldest known mathematics texts in existence are the Shulba Sutras. In the entire world, if you search for oldest mathematics book, it is in Sanskrit. The book title is Shulba Sutra. He further writes that I should also add Shulba Sutra is really not a mathematics book. There is only one chapter on mathematics. There are other chapters or other subjects. The Vedic Hindu, in his great quest, made progress in various arts and sciences to a considerable extent and with a completeness which is unparalleled in antiquity. This is the shower of praise that Seidenberg will pour. Seidenberg is of the view that several historians are underrating and underestimating the works of Hindu. He says that Shulba Sutra itself is much, much older than what historians are thinking. From Shulba Sutra, I am quoting a passage. This time it is not a verse. It is just prose, one sentence. Dirgha chaturasrasya akshnaya rajjuhu parshvamani tiryanmani cha yati prithak bhute kurutaha tati ubhayam karoti. Language of a rishi, sage, bodhayana. Here there are technical terms. Dirgha chaturasra means rectangle, akshna means diagonal, parshva and tirya are the two adjacent sides of the rectangle, and then when translated, I have not translated it. When translated, it means this: if you take any rectangle, then the square of the diagonal will be equal to the sum of the square of the two sides. This is, in a guise, same as the Pythagoras theorem, which says that if you take any right-angled triangle, then the sum of the square of the hypotenuse is equal to the sum of the squares of the two sides. The two theorems, two statements convey the same thing. He, a Seidenberg, traced the origins of Egyptian and old Babylonian mathematics to Vedic mathematical texts known as the Shulba Sutras. I am stating this because there are other historians who feel that Egyptian and old Babylonian civilizations are older, but Seidenberg doesn't agree with that. Seidenberg observed the elements of ancient geometry found in Egypt before 2100 before Christ and Babylonia approximately 1900 to 1750 before Christ. They all stem from a ritual system of the kind observed in the Shulba Sutras. Maybe I should say something about the Shulba Sutras. Shulba Sutras, as I said earlier, is not a mathematics book. It is a book on ritual systems. Vedic rituals are to be performed. For performing Vedic rituals, certain platforms or altars or vedis are to be constructed. Not only that, certain structures, brick structures, something like buildings, have to be constructed in different shapes, in the shape of a bird, for example. For them, much of geometry is required as a tool, and there is a chapter to develop the tools for those Vedic rituals. Similarly, for Vedic rituals, time observation is important. It has to be performed in some fixed particular kind of time, and that is why astronomy became important in Vedic rituals. The word Shulba Sutra itself means, Shulba means a thread for measuring. Sutra means aphorisms. short sayings for using the threads for measurements. The next scholar is from Australia, A.L. Basham. He is a historian with the Australian National University in Canberra. He is no more now. His most popular book is The Wonder That Was India, published in London in 1954. The title of the book itself, he conveys his admiration to Indian works. The Wonder That Was India. This book is the most popular because even today, in many universities, including our University of Hyderabad, in history department, this book is a prescribed textbook. Every student learns this. In fact, after the demise of this professor of Australian National University, some other person has written volume 2 of this book with the same title, The Wonder That Was India, Volume 2. It is available from Amazon.com. It is the most widely used introduction to Indian civilization. This is the title page of the book. A.L. Basham, The Wonder That Was India. Etc. And the accurate value is 1.414213, etc. And the two coincide in the first five decimal places. He writes, no one is certain how the Indians arrived at the method. This may have been the first recorded method of evaluating square roots. First in the world, possibly. But even though he writes that no one is certain how they arrived at the method, now we are certain. Even the method by which they arrived at this answer is clear. Bodhayana, in his Sulba Sutra, has used an algorithm which is something similar to continued fraction. That will become a separate topic. This is about Dick Teresi, co-author of the God Particle, God Particle book, and the author of Last Discoveries, The Ancient Roots of Modern Science. Both books are selected as New York Times Book Review notable books. He has been the editor-in-chief of Science Digest, Longevity, EQ, Omni, and has written for the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and the Atlantic, among other publications. This is only to say that these scholars themselves are not ordinary persons. This is Dick Teresi. This is the title page of his book, Last Discoveries, from where I have quoted this passage. Passage in Sanskrit, this time not a verse, but a prose line. Pramanam tritiyena vardhine, tat chaturchena, atma chatustrimsha munena, avishesha. This is the Sanskrit passage. Pramanam, the quantity that you take, if you take it as one, then tritiyena vardhine, you increase it by 1/3 of it, you get 1 + 1/3. Then, Pachchaturchena, 1/4 of that number, that is 1/3 × 4. Vardhayet, you have to increase it. Then, Atma Chatustrimsha Unena, Una means you have to subtract, because already you have exceeded that square root of 2. Subtract by what? 1/34 of itself. This term 1/3 × 4, take 1/34, one of that, I'm getting 1/3 × 4 × 34. Then an important word, savishesha, there is something more. That is translated here as plus dot dot dot. There is something more. It is clear that Bodhayana was aware that it is not a rational number, and not only that, he has a specific method of describing an infinite series which gives better and better rational approximations to that number. In fact, there are commentators of this work. Sulba Sutras have many commentaries, and commentators have realized, have been aware that this is part of an infinite series, and have taken trouble to calculate the fifth term also. There is a pattern here. The fifth term should be of the form 1 by 3 into 4 into 34 into something. Not only that, if these rules and patterns are understood, this is coming by a very good algorithm, which in modern days we will call as greedy algorithm for finding the value. This can be used for any irrational number, and Bodhayana himself has used it not only for square root of 2, he has used it for the calculation of pi also, and his commentators have written similar infinite series expansion for the square root of 3, and historians of mathematics are thinking that infinite series originated only 4 or 5 centuries ago, but this is a pre-Christian era book. Next, I pass on to another computer scientist, this time Donald Erwin Knuth, a renowned computer scientist, professor emeritus of the art of computer programming in Stanford University. He has been called the father of analysis of algorithms, a subject within computer science. He has written many books. I am going to quote from one of his books. I would also add that some 2 decades ago, all universities, including Indian universities, including our university, was prescribing this particular book from which I am quoting as a standard textbook. But now computer science has advanced so fast that this book is no longer used as a textbook. I am quoting from his book, the binomial coefficients, the coefficients that come in the expansion of 1 plus x whole power n, which is taught in the high schools, have a long and interesting history. The earliest known appearance of binomial coefficients is in a 10th century commentary 1000 years ago due to Halayudha on an ancient Hindu classic. This Hindu classic is of pre-Christian era. The Chandas Sutra is the name of that book, original book. In about 1150 AD, another Hindu mathematician, Bhaskaracharya, gave a very clear exposition of binomial coefficients in his book, Leelavati. This is taken from the book, Fundamentals of Algorithms. There is one small mistake here. Section 6, Chapter 4 refers to Leelavati. In Leelavati, Chapter 4, Section 6, this is discussed. There is a formula which is taught to our students, maybe in 11th class or so, junior college. There is a formula for n choose r, the number of ways of choosing r objects from n objects. Suppose there is a basket of n balls, I want to choose only r balls. How many ways are there to choose it? There is a formula for that. That formula is now in this Sanskrit passage of Mahavira. Ekadhyekottaratah padamurdhvadharyatah kramotkramashah sthapya pratilomadhinam pratilomadhnenabhajitam saram. One verse of Mahavira in chapter 6 of Ganita Sara Sangraha. This is verse number 218. As I mentioned, there are totally 1200 verses in this book. The result, that is the answer that we want to obtain as n choose r, it is the quotient of 2 products, namely the product of numbers in the reverse order and the product of numbers in the direct order. In the numerator, I have to write starting from n numbers in the reverse order, n into n minus 1 into n minus 2 and so on. I write r of them. Then in the denominator, I write 1 into 2 into etc. into r. This is the formula for this number of ways. For this also, there are very interesting anecdotes which I have not put in my slides. There is a book which is available in many libraries, and I am sure it should be available in MS University of Baroda library also, titled History of Mathematics, author Smith. Smith is considered as a standard historian. There, in the book on History of Mathematics, he delves on this also, the history of this particular formula also. He says that this was discovered in Europe in the 17th century by a gentleman by name Harry Bond. He is correct to the extent that he knows. Harry Bond was the first discoverer. He cannot blame him because he was not knowing that it was available in Maharaja's book long, long ago. But later, in 1912, English translation of the Maharaja, this book was first published. Together with English translation, this passage was published. And it was published in Bangalore, Mysore. And the publishers thought that the value will be added if it is shown to E. Smith, because he is a big historian of mathematics. Therefore, they not only sent that book to him, they wanted a preface from him. He wrote a preface for this book. After that, Smith's History of Mathematics, second edition came. People were anxiously looking for what he is writing now. Unfortunately, he did not make any change from the first edition. He continued to say that this formula was first found in Europe by the Ergodic Theory in the 17th century. That sentence remained as it is. Therefore, many persons wrote to him, not only from India, but also from other countries, saying that this is already there in Maharaja's book, you have written a preface for that, and now you are not including it in your revised edition. He didn't. Therefore, he was criticized by other historians of mathematics. And many books by Indian authors and European authors have started revising. They started writing that the formula for n choose r was first found in India by Maharaja in Gatita Sara Sangraha. I have read many books stating that, and many a time I have also in my lectures said that it is found in India first time by Maharaja in Gatita Sara Sangraha. Later, it turned out that we were also wrong. We were only partly correct. It is found in India, but not first by Maharajacharya. There are still earlier books where this formula is available, and one of that is Varahamihira. One professor, Madhavan, corrected me, saying that you should not say that this Mahavira was the first. And I said that I read it so in so many books. He said they are all wrong. Varahamihira mentions this formula. Of course, it is not the same flora, it will be some other flora, it will be in some other formula. But the formula is known in India much earlier. This kind of experience I have come across in several of these. Knowingly or unknowingly, I say that Bodhayana was the first, not the Pythagoras, to say Pythagoras theorem. But how are we sure that Bodhayana was the first? What does Bodhayana himself say? He says that for thousands of years in India, tradition has passed on so many formulas to him. He is compiling them. Therefore, we should not say that Bodhayana is the first to mention Pythagoras theorem. It is there in India for thousands of years. For one more reason also. What is his manual for? It is intended for performing some Vedic rituals. But those Vedic rituals were being performed for at least 8,000 years before Bodhayana, he is only compiling the manual. Next, a very famous mathematician, Laplace, whom no MSc student will miss. Laplace transforms are very important nowadays. A citizen of France, he is known for his proof of the stability of the scalar system. What does he write about Indian mathematics? He says how grateful we should be to Hindus who found this great decimal system way of writing numbers. If it is 2012, we write 2012. In Roman system, they wrote it differently. For 1000, they will write M. For 2000, they will write MM. Then 12, they will write some other symbols. This method, which does not occur to the minds of such mighty mathematicians as Archimedes and Apollonius, these are Greek mathematicians. No doubt they are writing. They have made a lot of contributions. But this way of writing numbers did not occur to them. It occurred only to the Hindus. This is what Laplace is saying. A passage about this way of writing numbers, called nowadays called Hindu Arabic numerals, developed in Hindu, transmitted through Arabs to Europe. This passage is taken from Brahma Sutra Shankara Bhashya of Adi Shankara in a philosophy book. I should add, he is not saying that he is discovering this notation. Yathacha ekapi lekha sthananyatvena nivishamana eka dasha shata sahasra adi shabda pratyaya bhedam anubhavati. He gives this numerals, this place value notation of writing numbers as an example for his theory of Advaita, or explaining something there. He says, look at this way of writing the numbers. Same symbol one, written in one place means the number one. Written in another place, the same symbol gives the meaning number 10. In another place, it gives the meaning number 100. In yet another place, the same symbol has the meaning 1000. The meaning changes depending on the place where the symbol is put. This is an example to illustrate his theory that same thing can represent many things. Nothing is permanent. यथा चैकापि रेखा स्थानान्यत्वेन निविशमाना एकदशशतसहस्रादि शब्दप्रत्ययभेदम् अनुभवति. That means this decimal place value notation was so much prevalent in those days that people can easily understand if this example is given to illustrate Shankara's philosophy. Another person, this time a professor of philosophy himself, Fritz Stahl, is a professor emeritus of philosophy until a year ago. He received a PhD in Indian philosophy and Sanskrit, not the place from where he received it, from University of Madras and from Banaras Hindu University. He keeps coming to India very frequently. He is an admirer of Vedic rituals. His quotation: infinite power series that are expansions of pi, and the trigonometric functions sine, cosine, and so forth were discovered by Madhava in the late 14th century. Almost three centuries before, they were discovered in Europe by Gregory. Of course, we disagree with this also, because sine and cosine functions were there in Aryabhatta's work much, much earlier. And infinite series, but this particular thing, infinite power series that are expansions of pi, that is available in Madhava's work and its components. Madhavacharya is a Kerala mathematician in 1300 plus AD. He continues to write, India's strength lies in abstract theory, as is evident from her means India's mathematics and linguistics. And Fritz Stahl himself is a professor of linguistics and philosophy. This is what is nowadays known as Maharaja Gregory series, and until 3 decades ago, what is known as Gregory series. And our textbooks will simply call it as Gregory series, but Mathematical Association of America and other books, they will call it as Maharaja Gregory series. Ekatriyat yoda sankhyabhihi dhatte vete anukramati ojana sanyute tyaktva yugma yoga iha smritam labdhinam avasanam syat na tathapi muhu krite. This is taken from the book Yukti Bhasha. Yukti Bhasha is not Madhava's book. It is a book of a student of Madhava. That student in his book says that infinite series expansion is taught to him by his teacher, Madhava. Eka, one, three, adi, etc. Ota, sankhya, odd integers. One, three, etc. take the odd integers. Bhattetu, etetu, anukramat, one after the other in the same order. Put them in the denominator. We will get 1 by 1, 1 by 3, 1 by 5 and so on. Odana, sanyutehe, tekva. Among them, take the odd terms. Take the odd terms, add them. Then, yugma, yogam, tekva. Take the even terms, add them and remove them. That is for even terms, put the negative symbol. Then we get 1, minus 1 by 3, plus 1 by 5, minus 1 by 7, etc. Series has been stated now. Next sentence is only to say that it never ends. Labdhina, abhasanam, syati, natathapi, buhukute, go on indefinitely. It is an infinite series. I have only 5 minutes, and it is very appropriate to stop in the middle but saying a few things about Srinivasa Ramanuja. He contributed to number theory and combinatorics. He is appropriate here because he developed so many infinite series. Something similar to what Madhavacharya did, what Yukti Bhatta quotes. And one of them, very remarkable, very wonderful. 1 + 1/1 × 3 + 1/1 × 3 × 5 + 1/1 × 3 × 5 × 7 + 1/1 × 3 × 5 × 7 × 9 has written so many terms so that the pattern is clearly understood. Plus dot 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 infinitely. Plus from continued fraction 1 by 1 plus 1 by 1 plus 1 by 1 plus 1 etc. This is also going indefinitely. That sum will be equal to square root of pi e divided by 2. Something remarkable because pi is a wonderful number, e is another Euler's number. Exponential number, that is something very great. Square root of 2 is also coming. All these are combined in a simple infinite series. And this goes on, but as I said in the beginning, I will have to stop when I approach 1 hour. Now is the time. Baroda is a very famous French mathematician who has written volumes of books on foundations of analysis, whose books are not textbooks but are reference books available in all the universities like otherwise in the world. And he is writing about Pingala's Chandra Sutra and saying that Pascal's triangle is available in those places. But I am going to stop now. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Thank you for patient listening.